Hello and welcome to another episode with It's Dr. Dan, and this time we're going to be looking at intermolecular forces. So when we're looking at intermolecular forces, the big thing here is that we're trying to understand how molecules can interact with each other without creating actual bonds. So something like water, for example, when you have a glass of water, all these individual molecules that are in here, they're all water molecules, so H2O. But what are they all doing? Are they just kind of like all sitting there, just all wandering around, or are they interacting? And this is where intermolecular forces comes in. So the whole idea behind this, the word inter is referring to between molecules, and it all feeds off of the concept of dipoles from previous videos and polarity. So if I have two dipoles or two similar molecules, they can interact with each other like magnets attracted to one another. So if you ever take two magnets, very opposite charges, they attract, they're going to bring each other closer as a result. So these are attracting each other. However, they are not bonding because they're not sharing electrons. So going back to something like our little water analogy, if I take a water molecule, so I have a Lewis structure for water, and I label that with my delta pluses, delta negatives, like so. What we're actually going to see is that each of these different positives and negatives can create an intermolecular force with another molecule that is of similar quality. So let's say if I have another water that is nearby, and for this one, we also have the same ideas. We have the positive and negative charges here. Well, I have negative, positive, negative, positive. So we have an intermolecular force or IMF. So we have attraction. So whenever we have that attraction, well, that is what we're looking for. So what types can we have? Let's look at how we can really tell the difference. So there's four major types. So they are called dispersion, dipole-dipole, hydrogen bonding, and ion-dipole forces. So one thing you might see that there is a lot of in this one is the word dipole. So you see it once, twice, three times. And so what that's kind of telling you is that, oh, so two out of the four have the word dipole in it. That must be a major characteristic of these. So they're all about the polarity that we've talked about in previous videos. So if you weren't sure about electronegativity and polarity, go back to my other two videos that were posted previously on them. I have two parts so far on that. Hopefully it'll help kind of clear that up before we talk about how they're attracted to one another. So let's go through them and how let's label them. So the first one, so dispersion. Dispersion is a force that occurs between all molecules. Okay, so dispersion forces occur between all molecules. So it's anything with electrons. Now, even though it's all molecules, it's the strongest force for nonpolar molecules. All right, so whenever we have a nonpolar molecule, that's all it's capable of doing. So that's whenever you see something nonpolar and you could label that, you know its only force is this. So what's happening? So let's say if I take one of the simplest nonpolar elements out there, and that would be like a noble gas. So what if I take a helium atom? Now, how many electrons does a helium have around it? Well, if you remember, it goes hydrogen, then helium. So it has two electrons. So if I have those two electrons that are around it, how exactly is that going to be kind of displayed around its core? Well, probability dictates it should be in as far away from each other as possible, right? Like charges repel. However, what if we have a helium that collides with another helium? Being that helium is a gas, collisions happen all the time. How exactly would that occur if they collide? Well, if that were to happen, that picture is going to change. So, whenever we have a collision, or it's the same way as if you've were kind of running and someone cut in front of you and you had to stop, or let's say if you had to slam on the brakes of your car, what's to happen? Well, you jut forward in that seatbelt and you feel that momentum shift. So being that electrons are really, really light, they're going to fly forward as a result. So we have a concentration of electrons on one side of the atom. Same thing with the other one, right? Because they collided with each other. All of a sudden, those electrons in the first one repelled the ones on the other one. So when that happened, it caused a temporary dipole to form. So we have a positive section, negative, positive, negative. So we have temporary instantaneous dipole. Instantaneous. I hopefully spelled that right. Okay, so when that happens, we have a brief moment of attraction between these, and it's an extremely weak interaction. Okay, so that's the first one. It's with nonpolar. Now, what are the trends with it in terms of strength? So this is with all molecules, but for nonpolar, this is the strongest. So the way that it grows in strength increases as molar mass increases. So the bigger the molecule, the more electrons, the stronger the dispersion forces. So that's stronger dispersion. So that is our first force. Let's go into our second one. Our second one was dipole-dipole. All right, so what was something with a dipole? Well, that was whenever we had a molecule that had a partial positive and a partial negative charge. So let's draw a molecule that would show that. So what if I had a C double bonded to an O with two hydrogens on both sides? So for this one, we can try figuring out the electronegativity. But if you remember from previously, one of our trends was that a CO bond is polar, meaning that the oxygen on this one is going to be slightly negative. So we'll have a delta negative on this side, delta plus on that. Now, if this is in a similar solution of, let's say, other formaldehyde, so other CH2Os, so how would they be attracted to each other? Well, very similar to dispersion, being that these have permanent dipoles, we can kind of maybe imagine that these are all going to be about how they can kind of rotate in on themselves. So I take this molecule and I rotate it. So that way the positive side is exposed, maybe the negative side. And we bring it closer to, let's say, another CH2. Well, we're going to see that we have a delta plus. Delta negative, delta plus, and we can relabel the other side as well. So we have negative, plus, negative, plus. So they are going to make an intermolecular force between each other. So this is our dipole-dipole, and this is between polar molecules. So it has to be polar as a result. So keep that in mind. If we have something that's polar, then we know that it is going to be attracted. So that is dipole dipole. The next type of force is whenever we have hydrogen bonding. So it has to be another very specific definition. For this one, hydrogen bonding is a subtype of dipole dipole. Hydrogen bonding has to fit the definition where it has to look like this. We have to have a molecule, let's say an atom X, connected to a hydrogen. So that's where this part comes into play. And that thing is going to be interacting. So that is where the bonding part comes in, with something that is electronegative. Okay, so in this instance, X has to be a very specific electronegative atom. It has to be something that's very, very negative. So if you remember from our electronegativity trends, the farther you were up and to the right of the periodic table, the more electronegative something was. So something like fluorine, nitrogen, oxygen have to be one of our atoms. So it can only be a hydrogen can only be attached to fluorine, nitrogen, or oxygen, nothing else. So when we drew water earlier, hydrogen bonding, we just didn't give it a name. So water, hydrogen bonding to another water molecule, we showed an instance of hydrogen bonding. So oxygen interacts with the hydrogen, and we have something like this. And we can label the different charges, right? We have minus, plus, minus, plus. But this shows hydrogen bonding because this fits our definition. Our definition in this instance is an oxygen is bound to a hydrogen, and that's interacting with another oxygen in this situation. So another example of hydrogen bonding would be like if I take, okay, so if it has to be fluorine or in hydrogen, what if I do HF and that was interacting with another HF? So in this case, we have delta plus, delta minus. That's going to be interacting with another HF. And we can label them as positive and minus. And we can also show an instance of hydrogen bonding. Now, with hydrogen bonding, there's a little more nomenclature or naming that comes into this. So there's the hydrogen bond donor, and there's also the hydrogen bond acceptor. The donor, so the hydrogen bond donor contains the hydrogen. So in this case, the hydrogen bond donor is this molecule here because the hydrogen is interacting, whereas on the left over here, this is the hydrogen bond acceptor, being that the delta negative molecule or delta negative atom, in this case fluorine, is receiving the hydrogen bond. So it's a further naming system. All right. Now, the last type of interaction is ion-dipole. So you might be able to get an idea of what ion-dipole is. So the first part of the name, an ion. So you need something with a real charge. So one example of something with a real charge is, let's say if I take sodium and chlorine, for example. So if you add salt to water, what's happening? If you add sodium, if you add salt to, let's say, water for making pasta or making rice, what happens to it? It all of a sudden dissolves in front of your own eyes. Why is that? Well, that's because of ion-dipole interactions. So if the water, which has a dipole on it, were to interact with sodium, how would that orient itself? Well, the water would be the oxygen side, which has the partial negative, is going to be interacting with the positive part of the sodium. And we can draw a bunch of waters all around that sodium interacting. So when that happens, those interactions are going to surround that part of that atom there, or that ion. And the same thing's going to happen on the other side. But instead, or if we have our chlorine, how is that one going to interact? Well, being that it's a partial negative, is it going to be the oxygen or the hydrogen is going to interact? And you might be able to take a guess, is that the hydrogen in this case is going to interact with the other side because hydrogen has the slightly positive side. So when that happens, we're going to be putting little positive hydrogens all around that chlorine ion to show how it's being solvated or dissolved in this case. So we have all those little interactions on all sides. And that is how we can show interactions between all these different species. So the H's, O's, H's, they're all going to be surrounding it, almost like a flower kind of surrounding it. It's actually pretty cool. So that is ion-dipole forces. So this is how attractions occur between molecules. And one thing you're going to be seeing is that like molecules like to interact with like molecules. So the last thing I'm going to leave you with is our final saying from intermolecular forces, and this is about solubility, is that like dissolves like. Meaning that polar molecules dissolve polar molecules, and then nonpolar dissolves nonpolar. So similar molecules like to interact with each other. So remember that for future videos and for to maybe help you with any homework that you might have, is that when you're trying to figure out what's going to be interacting with each other, it's going to be all about like dissolves like when you're looking at all the different types of forces. I hope this video helped you at least be able to understand the basics for trying to understand intermolecular forces. And hopefully we'll see you next time for future videos. Please hit that like and subscribe button so you see future content, and I'll keep on making it for all of you guys out there. I'll see y'all later. Bye.